Hello, everybody, and welcome to Deeper Dive, where we uncover the deeper philosophical origins and implications of current economic, political, and social events. As always, I'm joined by Professor Nicholas Dungey. Nick, how are you today?
I'm doing great, Walker. Thank you. Hello, everyone.
So good to see you. Hello, everyone. Yep. I want to get to a few quick shout-outs before we get started. So first, I want to again mention our partnership with Diamond Media Group, DMG, as we like to say. Tony Diamond, thanks for your help in producing our podcast. We certainly appreciate it. Next, the big shout-out for our...
We have a producer.
No way.
Our big shout-out for our big donor this week.
Lisa Botongino is a long-time member of the DSU community. She was one of our first listeners. Back when we had six listeners.
I remember.
She was one of the six.
That's awesome.
And she has been listening and supporting us for 3 years now. And I want to say thank you, Lisa, from the bottom of my heart, from
big
our
thank
heart.
You, Lisa. Yes.
Thank you so damn much. Much love to you. And thank you.
Okay, so let's get started.
Yep.
We
have no idea how this is going to go.
Well, my favorite part of this is we're going to call this history a brief history of truth. And we're playing on Hawking's book, of course.
Yeah, just having fun. And by the way, that's right. We'll get to that.
Yes.
That's right.
I thought the way you described the episode was so great. We need to do an NCS episode on the truth.
On the crime scene.
On the crime scene of what is the truth?
Like, people's idea of the truth and how the word truth gets used in the public discourse has been murdered.
It's dead, and we are going to get to the bottom of what happened.
We have to do an NCS on the massacre of the truth and the way the truth is used and understood and deployed in current public discourse.
Okay. But in order to do that...
So are we cool? We're pop culture, right? We're going to do a forensics,
So let's start in the A block.
Yep.
We have to do the background. We have to do the history of truth. And people, because of their... How do you always refer to it? Their lineage, their...
Their inheritance.
Their inherited ideas of what truth is. That people don't understand that once upon a time there were different conceptions... Oh. Of truth. And so we'll go back.
Yep.
We're going to start with the origins of truth with Socrates and Plato.
Absolutely.
We're going to move into metaphysics.
We're going to introduce the origin of metaphysics.
We're going to talk about the fact-value distinction.
How metaphysical thought undergoes an extraordinarily important transformation in the early 1600s.
During the Renaissance,
fact,
right.
Fact-value distinction.
And then move into postmodernism.
And then we'll finish with an introduction to Nietzsche about what... postmodernism and how it critiques post-metaphysical accounts of truth, mind, and language.
And finally, and I want to make sure we get to this, and this is why I'm putting it on the record, the absence of truth is not postmodern.
That's correct.
Okay. And
absolutely.
So I'm giving the audience a quick teaser to what's in the C block when we find out what's going on with the truth.
Right. Well, the absence of a metaphysical notion of truth does not deny the possibility of useful notions of truth.
And this is why I get the big bucks, because I get to decipher what you say for people who are listening and don't have a master's in political philosophy. So let's get started.
All right. So look, in this episode, as we've just suggested in a playful sort of way, both with reference to the title, A Brief History of Truth, and then our pop cultural reference to our NCS forensics of the truth. In this episode, what we're going to do is identify the basic conceptions of what are called metaphysical ideas of truth, and we're going to chart its historical transformation through not only historical time, but through different sort of systems of thought about metaphysical truth. All right? Now, why do we have to do that? We wanted, for a long time now, we've wanted to do a show on fake news, on alternative facts, on post-truth society, and how that sort of constellation of ideas is operating in the current political discourse, the political public space about this, and it's a mess. This is the NCS part of it. This is the there's been a massacre that's happened here. Now, before we can deal with that, we have to provide a very basic history of truth.
Right.
So we are at least clear at a very simple way mm-hmm. what we are saying when we use the word, what it means, and how it changes over time.
Right.
So that's what we're doing right now in this show.
Right.
And so we're going to do a brief history of truth, and that means we've got to begin with the origin of truth as it is understood in Western society.
Let's get started.
And you were a student of mine 10 years ago.
Has it been that long?
And for every course that I teach on the introduction of political philosophy, this is the story that I tell. The idea of truth as it begins and as we have, for the most part, understood it in Western society, begins with Socrates, but especially Plato. Socrates mm-hmm. is great student Plato. And Socrates and Plato are monumental figures in Western society because first Socrates, in a very loose way, and more strictly Plato and Aristotle, the Neoplatonists, the emergence of the Roman humanists, and even the emergence of New Testament Christianity as it gets developed in about 325 AD in Rome and all the way up to current time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so the origin of the truth begins with Socrates and Plato.
Okay.
And why does it begin with Socrates and Plato, and what did they say? Socrates and Plato are extraordinarily important to Western society because Socrates first, very generally, and Plato more concretely, was the first to say, look, there is an objective truth that exists out there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, originally, Plato thought of that as a pure idea.
Mm-hmm.
There were a set of pure ideas that were the conditions of possibility for anything. There was a pure idea in mathematics. There was a pure idea for a tree. There was a pure idea for human nature, right? There's an objective truth to all of the things and processes that occur in the material and physical world.
Right, so there was a pure idea of how to govern. There
well,
was a pure,
that was a consequence of this.
There was That's a pure correct. Idea of how one should live a good life.
Absolutely.
And one spent their day yep. going through trying yep. to achieve that pure idea, that truth.
That's the end of that's the sort of consequence of this.
Right.
Now, when Plato argues, Plato's the first to argue in Western culture that an objective truth exists. Now, therefore, why he's important and what we need to talk about just a little bit, and I don't want to bore the listeners too much.
Yeah, too
but,
late.
But this is the origin of what is called metaphysics.
come on.
This is
now the, I got to edit that out.
Why? That's good.
No.
So this is the origin of metaphysics, right? And this is an incredibly important idea. Right, and I want to talk very briefly about what metaphysics is, just very briefly.
Okay.
Now, Plato is the origin of metaphysical philosophy. Now, in the history of the West, there are three great systems of metaphysical thought. There's Platonic and Roman philosophy. There is the emergence of New Testament Christianity as a metaphysical theology and science.
Right.
Now, Plato gets this ball rolling mm-hmm. because he's the first to articulate a metaphysical argument. And all metaphysical arguments, whether they're philosophical, religious, or scientific, okay. have a structure and two parts of the structure.
Okay.
One, all metaphysical arguments argue that there is a truth out there and it has an external dimension to it. They say, first, there's some objective reality out there. There's some objective
right.
condition
okay.
or reality that exists. The supra-reality. Right? The Christians call this heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Plato called it a super reality. Now, this objective condition exists and it transcends our time and space. So all metaphysical arguments argue that there are at least two dimensions of reality. There's a super reality, this objective super reality, and there's the reality that you and I spend our life in, the reality of time and space, change and movement and death. Okay? So an objective condition exists. This condition transcends our reality. So we have a binary reality.
Right, okay? And you mentioned science as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Science believes that that truth exists in natural law, yep, in
and
physics, and processes.
Beautiful.
And that was there long before us, and it will be there after we're gone.
This is where we're. This is why it's important to talk about this.
Right, so...
So this objective condition exists. It transcends our time and space. Two, this space, whatever it is, the super reality, this heaven, whatever it is made up of, it's constituted by, either in Plato's just simple sense, pure ideas. And that's what I was saying earlier. There's a pure idea of justice. There's a pure idea of human nature. There's a pure idea of the perfect circle. This is what Plato called the forms, okay? Or if you are committed to one of the great theologies, right? This objective condition is constituted by God, right? Whatever this super reality is, it's God. God or God occupies this. And as you just beautifully said, in the scientific tradition, this objective reality is constituted by pure laws, pure processes, natural laws, okay?
Right.
So an objective condition exists. It is constituted either by pure ideas, God, or natural laws and processes. And here's the important part. Those pure ideas, that conception of God or those processes, if they are metaphysical, those ideas, that conception of God or those processes are timeless and changeless, right? Right? Whatever, and by the way, we still haven't discovered it, and we're always on the hunt for it. If you're Platonic, right?
Sure.
This is the idea. But whatever that pure idea of justice is, it has a timeless and changeless definition.
Right.
And what that means is that it applies everywhere, all the time, to everybody.
Right.
That's what gives its objective status, right? When people say that the truth is objective, the truth is universal, they're making a metaphysical argument in the sense that whatever that idea is, whatever that conception of God is, whatever that theory of that natural law, the speed of light or gravity or the circulation of blood in the human body, right? Whatever that process, that God or that idea that is being discussed, whatever it is, applies everywhere, all the time, and to everybody.
Right.
It's universal. And it's really important that people get their head around that. Because that's what makes the truth in Western society.
Right, is that it doesn't change.
It doesn't change.
Right, it's always the same thing.
It's not a matter of your perspective. Or let me put it this way. It doesn't derive from your perspective.
Right, it exists with or without you.
With or without you and prior to you.
Right.
Okay, so this is critical. And then the fourth part about the external side, and I love you so much, you've got it. And this sets up this last part. Not only does an objective condition exist, it's made up of ideas, God, or natural processes. Right? Whatever those things are, they're timeless and changeless. And that's what gives it its objective condition, the truth. That's what gives the truth as we conceive of it in Western culture. Right? And most importantly, as you had gestured to, these pure ideas, this notion of God, or these natural laws are the conditions of possibility for our awareness and comprehension of ourselves.
Right.
It is because those things exist that we have awareness of who we are and can comprehend the external world. Right?
Right.
Right. And that's what you had gestured to a minute ago with reference to science. Plato makes the same idea. These pure ideas exist up in some objective reality. Right? They've always been there. They're timeless and changeless. And it's because those things exist. Right? That you and I have awareness of them, that you and I have the awareness that we do. Same. And again, most people, once they hear it broken down like this, go, oh yeah, of course, because they're already thinking like this. If you're a religious person, if you're a member, if you're committed to one of the great theologies,
right,
this argument is very simple to you, right? God has always what?
Always been there. Yeah.
In fact, technically speaking, God invented the universe.
Right.
God put the whole thing in motion. Right? And so if you're committed to the one of great theologies, you say God exists in an objective condition, right? He's timeless and changeless, right?
Right.
And God is the condition of possibility for the fact that you and I are aware of anything at all.
It's right in the Bible. Through him, all things are possible.
Right, beautiful. Right? Okay, God, see, this is metaphysics.
Right.
Now, we've only talked about the external side of all metaphysical arguments.
Okay.
Now all metaphysical arguments, for it to be a metaphysical argument, whether it's philosophy, religion, or science, has to have two sides of the argument.
Okay.
There's that external side that we just discussed, but there's also the individual side. And I know that's kind of a clumsy word, mm-hmm. but I'll just use it as a way of hope that the listeners get a sense of it.
Okay.
There's got to be an individual side of the metaphysical argument, right? Because think about it, right? All metaphysical arguments have to say, look, they have to, on the individual side, they've got to make a claim that there's something special and unique about human beings that allows them to know about the truth.
Okay.
Right? Just a silly argument, just to have fun. If you're a cat, do you know about the truth?
I guess not.
Right?
Right. Well, from a religious...
From a certain point of view.
Right.
This is just a playful example.
Of course. Right? But no, it makes me laugh, but it's very true.
Just to get the head around.
Yeah.
Right? So all metaphysical arguments have to have two sides of the argument, an external and an individual.
Right.
And therefore, all metaphysical systems of thought, philosophy, religion, or science... has to also make the claim. Not only is there a truth out there, but there's something special and unique about human beings that allows them to know about it.
Right.
Right? There's got to be some way, some capacity, some apprehensive ability for human beings to know it exists.
Hmm.
Right? And again, this is critical. This is why Plato's Plato.
Right.
Right? And this is why Christianity becomes what it does, and Islam does what it does, and now science. This is why science in its own way is so extraordinarily powerful.
Right, because the cat can't get its head around an equation, a mathematical equation that proves gravity.
That's right. So all metaphysical arguments say there's something special and unique about human beings.
Mm-hmm.
Now, look, for Plato, and this is the origin of all metaphysical arguments and ideas of truth, Plato said, look, what's special about human beings is that they're rational creatures. Okay, now what the hell did he mean by that? And he said, reason is a special faculty unique to human beings that if cultivated through certain activities of thought, in this case philosophy, gives them access to that truth. So reason is a sort of special bridge,
mm-hmm.
to put it in a clumsy way, to that truth.
Mm-hmm.
Reason is that special faculty unique to human beings that gives us awareness, first, that we're human,
right?
Right, and connects us to the truth, okay? And this is the origin of philosophy. This is the origin of the idea that philosophy is the discipline that cultivates reason, that tries to acquire truth about justice and truth about human nature and truth about how the hell to live.
Right.
That's why Plato is important,
right,
to Western history. That's why Aristotle is important. Now, another version of that, again, and most people will be familiar with this one because most people are still the heirs of some religious tradition, and even now in America.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're committed to Christian theology, or I don't know too much about Islam, but I imagine it's something similar. If you're committed to Christian theology, you accept this idea that there's something special about human beings.
Right.
Right? And what do they call it?
We have a soul.
They have a soul.
Yeah.
Right? It is because human beings possess a soul, and the soul is that opening to divine revelation, that opening to knowing God's word.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there's got to be some connection,
mm-hmm.
to that truth.
Right.
Either through some type of reason or the possession of a soul. Right? And that even in of itself is argued as something true about human beings.
Right.
Now, and it's so the individual side of metaphysics says, look, it's not just the truth is out there, but there's got to be something special about human beings that connects them. Okay? And that's reason or a soul. Now, again, another part of this argument. While reason and the soul are simultaneous with the body,
mm-hmm.
they're not produced by the body, right?
Right.
And they're not reducible to it.
Right.
Right. So both Platonic philosophy or the great theology say the body, the material dynamics, does not create reason.
Right.
Right. The material dynamics and processes of the body doesn't create the soul.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So the soul is somehow there. It's and again, sometimes metaphysics can be kind of a clumsy and awkward way because you got to think two things at once.
Right.
Right. Whatever my reason is, according to Plato, or whatever my soul is, according to the theologians, it's here. It's simultaneous with Nick Dungey's body, but the body doesn't produce reason or produce the soul.
Right.
And it's not reducible to it.
Yeah, you can't cut it out.
You can't cut it out.
Right.
And both positions argue. And this might be true for science, depending on a particular view. But certainly this is an argument for metaphysical philosophy and theology, that when I die, the mind goes somewhere, or the soul goes somewhere.
Right.
So the second part of the individual side of metaphysics is again, important. Not only is there a special faculty that connects people to the truth, but it's simultaneous with a body, but not produced by it.
Right.
Now, three, here we go. The last two are really important to set up the argument, okay? Or to move the argument forward. Now, according to Greek metaphysical philosophy and Roman humanism, as well as Christian theology, the purpose of life, okay, the purpose of life is to cultivate one's reason or open up one's soul, okay? Mm-hmm. To acquire as much knowledge as you can, and this is what you were gesturing to 10 minutes ago, to acquire as much knowledge as you can about justice and courage and friendship and love and what it means to be a human being, or in the theological sense, to acquire as much knowledge about divine revelation, to read the words of God, to incorporate the words of God, to acquire knowledge, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, four. The reason you acquire knowledge, okay, is to apply that knowledge to yourself, to be self-governing, to live well, to live a moral life. And this is the origin of the idea of a metaphysical morality, right? And this is what you were gesturing to 20 minutes. According to Plato, there's knowledge about moral truth. There's knowledge about virtue out there. There's knowledge about justice. There's knowledge about love, about friendship, about being a citizen, right? And you have reason. And if you cultivate that reason, you can acquire bit by bit through much struggle a knowledge about that. And you can cultivate, you can build that knowledge up. And then you can apply it to yourself to live well.
Right.
Right? What Socrates called nosce tepsom, know thyself, right? And be self-governing in this moral sense. Now, it's the same version in theology.
Right.
Right? You have this soul, you spend your life listening to the sermon, reading the word, applying the word to you so you live well, you live morally. Right? And this is a really important point. In the classical world goes from Plato, from the death of Socrates, 400 BC, 399 BC, all the way up to the 1600s.
Right.
The classical world covers Greek philosophy, Roman humanism, and the emergence of New Testament Christianity as the dominant theology. Mm-hmm. Okay? And in the classical world, all philosophy or theology was metaphysical, and both systems of thought were moral.
Right.
Right? Both systems of the truth were moral in the sense that they said there's an objectively superior and correct way to live.
Right. The word of God.
Or Platonic philosophy.
Right. It has been handed down.
Yep.
And this is how you should live, and that is true.
That is the truth.
And that is the truth.
That is the truth.
Right.
And it's based on your acceptance of the metaphysical argument, whether philosophy or religion, that some truth exists, that you and I can get access to it, that we can acquire knowledge, apply that knowledge, and live well.
Right.
Okay. Classical, the origin of truth in its metaphysical origin and its moral dimension.
Right.
Okay.
Then now, science comes along.
Now the heavy stuff. Really extraordinarily profound and deep and heavy stuff. Now, on the one hand, the emergence of metaphysical philosophy or theology, on the one hand, is an extraordinary gift to humanity, because prior to that, all knowledge was traditional. It was tribal. It was local. It was mythological.
Right.
Right. And it was structured very hierarchically. Right. There were very, very hierarchical and strict relationships of power and who had knowledge and who how people were defined in their socioeconomic roles and their relationships, right? And because that was what was,
right?
Right? There wasn't really little challenging of it. It was very static. So one of the reasons metaphysics is extraordinarily powerful and from one point of view a gift to humanity is because it says, look, it doesn't matter who you are. Mm-hmm. You have reason or you have a soul. And you can use that reason or open that soul to learn about who you are, to live in a certain way, and therefore you can, maybe you can't transcend your socioeconomic condition because feudalism or medieval economics
sure,
are what they
system
are.
Or whatever
right?
It is, right.
But you can certainly expand your mind.
Right.
Right. Right. And that's an extraordinarily powerful thing. And it begins the process of transforming world history. Now, as powerful and transformative as sort of philosophical and theological metaphysics is, with its promise that there's true knowledge and that you can live morally, it turns out that reasonable people across time begin to debate about these things.
Right.
They begin to debate the moral truth.
Okay.
Right? They begin to have arguments about what exactly God meant.
Protestants and the Catholics.
Here we go. Right? And a couple things happen in Western history that create this perfect storm of intellectual crisis and political crisis. First, in the early 1500s, as you just so beautifully said, right, Luther nails the thesis on Wittenberg and creates the rupture in the Catholic Church.
Right.
And Luther says the Catholics, that the Catholic hierarchy is wrong about the moral truth. They've got God wrong.
Right.
So inside the dominant metaphysical morality emerges a very savage debate about what God is. Now, because that debate is about the most profound and important things, salvation, hell, sin, right? The consequences of that debate become very intense. And this is the origin of the theological political crisis in the West, right? And this is the origin of political conflict over debate about who knows God best.
Right.
All right. So debate about moral truth gets exercised in politics, and that leads to civil war. Civil war leads to anarchy. Anarchy leads to suffering. So already in the 1500s, emerging in the 1600s, there is a growing awareness among intellectuals, political leaders, that, boy, politicizing moral truth is very dangerous because you can't politically force someone to believe something, or you can't coerce someone to change their deepest beliefs.
Right.
Okay? So there's already beginning in the 1500s, in the early 1600s, the emergence of what will become liberal philosophy as the strategy that begins to help people to think of their moral truth, I suppose is still truth, but as a matter of public opinion. Right? Private opinion.
Right.
Right? And this is a very important moment. Right? There's emerging this idea, right, that, okay, now we have competing, serious and reasonable, competing debates about what God really is.
Mm-hmm.
But these debates are about the most serious things, so they quickly turn violent, right? And that violence creates social and political anarchy, right? So we've got to find a way,
right,
of dealing with the emergence of moral, of political violence conveyed through moral debate. And what happens is that there is the emergence in modernity that we don't rationally have a way. Okay? This is I'm giving you the punchline here. It's a slow emergence. But what emerges, and we've talked about this on many podcasts in the past, right? This is the origin of liberal philosophy. There emerges this awareness and this acceptance that as far as we are able to rationally know, we do not have a rational way of settling the debate between the Catholics and the Protestants,
right,
or the Christians and the Muslims. We don't have a rational, verifiable way of saying once and for all, with whatever counts as evidence, whatever counts as proof, yep, the Catholics are right. Nope, it happens to be the Mormons.
Right.
We don't have that. And so liberal philosophy emerges in and out of that awareness not only that philosophical awareness that we don't have a rational way of adjudicating the debate, but also out of the political awareness that we've got to find some way of tampering down this debate if we're going to live together peacefully.
Right, and the other thing that's going on here is the scientific revolution, in which it allows for another vehicle of truth. It can be, okay, I can prove this to you. I can show this to you. I can in a scientific way, I can show you I'm right.
This is how this is how science emerges.
Science emerges as another form of metaphysics.
Metaphysical truth.
Right. In other words, what people understand is there's a chasm in what people understand is true. You believe one thing to be true, I believe another thing
in
to
the
be
moral
true.
Context.
In a moral context. At the time, there was no distinction.
Up until the first wave of the scientific revolution,
there was no distinction. So people had different ideas of the truth. And because the stakes were so high, it brought people to blows, to battle.
Very vicious.
And so the scientific revolution comes, this perfect storm.
Kind of simultaneously. This is
as the science. So now the scientific revolution takes over.
Galileo is in Italy in the late 1560s. And so what happens in the late 1500s, early 1600s, and then develops and is now a dominant worldview.
Is the dominant worldview
that in the late 1500s and the early 1600s, there is what we call, and again, very clumsy, but just kind of get people's heads around it, there emerges what is called the fact-value distinction, right? The fact-value distinction. And the fact-value distinction is made possible because of the emergence of science. Right, the first wave of the scientific revolution emerges, right? And people like Galileo and Da Vinci and the early scientists, they are saying, you know what? We can acquire objective knowledge about how physical things happen, how physical processes, how physical laws happen. And those things are quite independent of your moral view of the world.
Right.
Okay? And this is what they call the bifurcation in metaphysics. There's a fact-value distinction. So all the way up until the 1600s, the 1500s, 1600s, all metaphysical thinking, philosophy, and religion is moral.
Mm-hmm.
But after the 1600s, there still remains a very powerful stream of metaphysics, but it's now governed by science. Right. And facts. And then everything else gets treated as a private opinion.
Yes.
Right? So now after the 1600s, in the emergence of liberal philosophy...
Well, it doesn't happen overnight.
No. This still continues today.
Right.
The battle's still going on.
The battle still continues, clearly science becomes the dominant... Because a scientist can tell you, I can prove it. There is a referee.
So they believe.
Right. Science can show you, I can show you this. If I drop the ball off the roof with this equation, it'll fall in this amount of time at this speed, and I can draw it up for you, and I can show you, and I can prove it, but what I can't
do... We can observe, test, and verify.
Exactly.
Right.
And that's important. Observe, test, and verify is very important.
Right.
Because...
And then we call those facts.
Right.
The consequence of that we call facts.
Facts. And religion at this point, I can't show you where your soul is. I don't know what happens to you when you die.
You can't prove God exists.
I can't. And so...
You can't prove that telling the truth as a moral claim of life is always objectively correct.
Exactly.
Right?
Right. And so that... I'm not going to say it gets pushed to the side, but it becomes a personal...
It's a private opinion.
It's a private opinion.
Values.
And that's written into the U.S. Constitution. As philosophers move on, you sort of see this line in history of... religion, I don't want to confuse my terms here, becoming not the governing force, but the personal opinion.
Yes.
And science becoming the dominant, because again, knowable or provable.
Given the way they understand reason and a particular type of language, called symbolic logic, mathematics.
Mathematics.
Okay. All right. Now, so you have this distinction, the fact-value distinction. So metaphysical thinking, understood as a type of truth, continues, and not just continues, but becomes very powerful in the West under the domain of science.
Mm-hmm.
So now we have the norm, and finally by the Enlightenment, we have the emergence of the normative social sciences. I have a PhD in political science, right? We have anthropology and history as a type of science, and political science and sociology, economics as a type of science, right? And the Enlightenment perspective is that you've got all these disciplines of scientific knowledge going out and examining and collecting data and analyzing that data to try to just extract, you know, little elements of truth here and there about different modes of activity, politics, sociology, economics.
Right.
And that's just the social science version. The medical sciences and the hard sciences, right? Everybody is well versed in the power of those things. Okay. And as you correctly said, morality is, and this is what becomes very unstable. This is an extraordinarily difficult and potentially destabilizing sort of structure of thought, especially now as this is playing out in modern America. If you are still committed to some version of moral metaphysics, if you're still committed to some version of moral truth, and you could be a Platonic philosopher. You could be a Platonic philosopher living in Santa Monica.
Right.
Or most likely you are committed to one of the great theologies.
You're a Christian.
Right.
Or
you're a Muslim.
Jew.
Right.
Yeah, sure.
Or a Jew. And so you are still, even though you live in the modern scientific world, you're still in many ways committed to something like an objective truth with a moral orientation.
Right.
Now here's... And by the way, because of the emergence of liberal philosophy and the separation and the treatment of moral truth as a private opinion, and then the separation, the attempted separation of church and state,
right.
this becomes a very unstable or a very difficult mental thing to do. Because if you are one of these people, you're asked to do something that's kind of psychotic in a way, because you're asked to take, because you still think that your conception of the moral truth is true.
Right.
Right?
In
your heart, you still believe you're right.
Sure.
Right? Absolutely. You know, but yet you live in a society where you're asked to treat your highest truth as a matter of
private opinion,
right. Which is equally as valid as everybody else's valid opinion.
Right.
So now in modernity, and especially in what's left of the Western liberal social welfare democracies, we've got truth still functioning as science, which we now call facts.
Right.
That's a fact. And then we have also the presence of all sorts of moral belief that is treated as private opinion, and all private opinions about moral things are treated equally.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, so, and that's where we are.
Right.
That has been,
well,
you know, that has been the sort of the gift of modern liberal political philosophy.
Right.
And by the way, it was a very important gift because as we have said in the past, we have described liberal philosophy as a strategy.
Right. It stops the bloodshed.
It stops the bloodshed.
Because everybody says, listen, all of your opinions are just as equally valid, but this is what we're going to go with because we can all sort of agree on
it.
Rational people can all sort of agree on this.
We can learn to tolerate each other.
If we stick to this set of facts, and we keep
as much as possible.
Yeah, your religion.
Out of the political space. That's right.
Now...
Yep.
I think we can get to postmodernism. Yep. But now, before we do, I have to make a quick joke. Yep. If anybody has read A Brief History of Time by Stephen Hawking, it is not a short book.
Right.
And so our brief history of the truth is not a short podcast.
That's right.
And so here we are moving on to postmodernism.
Right. Okay.
And
this is really important in terms of this brief history of truth.
Because this is Nietzsche now.
Yep, this is Nietzsche. Nietzsche emerges in the late 1800s, in the 1870s, 1880s, and Nietzsche is the first more fully developed postmodern thinker.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and what is postmodernism? Postmodernism is a view, if you will, that is very suspicious. Okay, and I will say suspicious technically.
Right.
It is very suspicious about the existence of what Plato called a pure idea.
Mm-hmm.
It is very suspicious about the existence of what theology calls God.
Mm-hmm.
And in a very interesting way, it's even suspicious in a type of operational way, and I'll explain that, of what science calls facts.
Right.
That's a more complicated. In fact, we did a podcast on that.
Oh, yeah, we did.
On the consequences of truth. We did a podcast on the consequences of truth about this dimension of the postmodern critique of metaphysical truth.
And I implore our listeners to go listen to it because we are not going to do it justice here in the amount of time that we have left. But we're just going to touch on it because
right now. Yeah. And so postmodern philosophy emerges with Nietzsche in an extraordinary suspicion of the existence of an objective truth and the suspicion about the idea that there's something unique about human beings that connects them to that. Now, they're suspicious about that because all postmodern philosophy is, in one way or another, a type of sort of organized on a linguistic philosophy, language. Mm-hmm. And technically, it's a type of nominalism. Nominalism is a theory of language.
Okay.
Nominalism is a theory of language that says the symbols, the A's, mm-hmm. right, or the W's and the A's and the L's, the symbols, even the basic symbol, the alphabet, the symbols, right? The symbols that are the most basic element of words and then words as sentences, sentences as languages, and languages as systems of thought. The symbols, the way we put together the symbols to make words, the way we put together words into sentences and grammatical structures, and the way the words have meaning, mm-hmm. right? And the way this meaning is temporalized in grammatical structures of past, present, future, and then the way these things develop to create comprehensive systems of thought as language, what Foucault would call discourse, what Nietzsche calls language. These, the symbols, the words, the definitions, the meanings, the values, all of those things are first human inventions, mm-hmm. right? And they're kind of arbitrary, right? Now, they're critically important inventions. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, there's no communication, there's no meaning, right?
Right.
Right? The symbols and the way the symbols are put together in words are and the word and the way the words have a meaning, mm-hmm. those are signs that represent things.
Right.
That signify things out there in time and space.
Right.
Okay? There are human inventions that signify things. Okay? But they're human inventions and because those things out there have no inherent meaning or purpose.
Right.
Right? The universe doesn't speak a language. God doesn't speak a language.
Right.
Right?
Human beings give it a language.
Human beings invent language, and in language give things out there in time and space a word, a definition, a meaning, and a value.
Right. And so...
And those are human inventions.
I am going to speed you up a little because mm-hmm. I know how detailed this can be. Mm-hmm. And so again, I'm going to implore our listeners to go listen to our other podcast about this. So postmodernism is just suspicious of the idea of a truth. What postmodernism says is anything that's out there, mm-hmm. okay, we have discovered it. Human beings have discovered it. We have named it.
Right.
And in naming it,
giving it meaning,
we give it meaning
and purpose and value.
Right.
Right. So let me put it this way. Here's something clumsy.
Okay.
And I beg the listeners, if I'm going to say this, and then if you have to keep repeating this part over and over again until you get it, it's critical.
Right.
Once you get it, everything, your whole mind turns.
Right.
Okay? Think about it like this. The postmoderns do not deny that an external reality exists. It's not a super reality in metaphysics, but they don't, right? And what they say, there are all sorts of things and processes. There are all sorts of things and processes that are the effects of causes that have nothing to do with human mind. And again, so I say to the listeners, if you have to stop and repeat it and listen to it 10 times to get your head around it, do it, because once you do it, it's an extraordinarily important thing. So let me repeat. From the postmodern point of view, it's common sense to say there are all sorts of things and processes that are the effects of causes that have nothing to do with human mind or language.
Mm-hmm.
Now, human beings can equip themselves with a language. We can invent a language.
Right.
We can invent A's and we can invent right. words.
Which will allow us
to signify and represent those things.
Right, and what they do and how they relate to us.
And we can create language as a tool to help us do interesting and important things.
Right.
Right? But the words themselves and the meanings themselves are our invention.
Right. And in that, and this is what brings us to this, we invent truth.
We invent truth.
Right.
Right.
So when a postmodernist says there's no such thing as truth, that's not what he's saying. That's
right.
That's a misrepresentation.
That's right. It's incorrect. He or she is suggesting that he or she is suspicious of the existence of what metaphysics calls truth.
Or an absolute truth.
Something
out there.
That is timeless and changeless.
That
has a language.
Right.
That has meaning. That is prior to us.
That is discoverable. That is knowable that we can tap into.
That the contents in our mind and the specific words we're somehow truthfully speaking mm-hmm. are in correspondence. That's what postmodernism is very suspicious of.
And in the same way, just because I want to make sure we get science in on this, and again, I remember talking about this on the other podcast,
yep.
is they are suspicious of science as well
mm-hmm.
in that those things that they call facts, we've invented
right.
the mechanisms to call them, name them, and do
yep.
something with
Absolutely.
Them.
Absolutely, right.
Okay.
Right.
So...
Yep, absolutely. And so let me go back just to help
Briefly.
You wrap this up.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? I'm not going to keep going on, but just to
okay.
put this together. So for postmoderns, right, they are suspicious of the existence of what metaphysics called truth or God. Now they argue, and this is how we began the podcast, they argue they have a developed sense of truth, and it's very important, operational.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. But truth is agreement inside language.
Right.
Right? Truth is agreement inside language. That's what truth is. Right? Truth is not correspondence to something objectively outside mind and language.
Mm-hmm.
Truth is produced in language. Now, again, this is very important. It is true. Language is a human invention.
Mm-hmm.
It gives meaning. And therefore, not only does it give meaning, but it's also an assertion of power.
Right.
Right? Because you're opening up the conditions of possibility in which things mean and function and have value. That's a very powerful thing. And not only is it a human invention and exercise of power, but it's constantly undergoing transformation.
Right.
Right? So, and by the way, that's what postmoderns call history. The process by which ideas emerge as inventions about how things are going to be named. The power relationships that got emerged in whose
right.
notion of reality is going to be dominant.
Right.
Right. And then the way that transformed over time. That's what Nietzsche calls genealogy. That's what postmoderns call history.
Right.
Right. Now, they don't deny that truth exists. They just deny that truth is produced in agreement with language.
No, they say truth is...
Yeah,
not truth. That they don't deny...
They define truth as agreement and language.
Agreement and language. So we all agree that you're wearing a black sweater.
Absolutely.
We've all agreed on that.
And that's true.
Right. Yeah. Now, I want to get to what we started the show with.
Right. Can I just say one funny thing?
One more.
One of the... Richard Rorty.
Okay,
right?
Yeah. I read Rorty.
Very controversial.
Yes.
Right? He's one of the most brilliant postmoderns, but he's also very controversial because mm-hmm. he made things so easily accessible that some people thought he had dumbed it down.
Right.
But Rorty, in his sort of je ne sais quoi postmodernism, said something very brutally postmodern, right? And he says, look, the difference for postmodern, for Nietzsche, for Rorty, the difference between a fact and opinion is a fact is something that it's fairly easy to get agreement on.
Mm.
An opinion is something that it's more difficult to get agreement on.
That's
right.
And that's where we are.
And that's where we are.
Right.
Now, so the relationship between a modernist notion of truth understood as some sort of science or private morality and now the emergence of postmodern suspicion of that
mm-hmm.
emphasis on language and language as a human invention and an assertion of power, that is the crime scene. That's
right, because this is it. This
that's
is where
we
are.
Are
today.
That's what, see.
And I want to spend the last couple of minutes of the podcast
yep.
just dissecting where we are, just looking over the body and going, okay, it was shot, it was stabbed, it was this, it was that. And here's what's happened. In a postmodern sense, since truth is agreement,
right?
If you can change the agreement,
right?
If you can use power to change
language as power.
Thank you. If you can, if you can change the language around something,
and the meaning inside the language,
you now have a new truth.
Oh, you have a new description of things,
right?
And you have a truth depending on how many people agree to it,
right?
Absolutely.
And so that's where we are.
Right.
And so that's what you're seeing in the media, in the current administration.
All of this conflict about a post-truth and, and, you know, the sort of alternative facts, all of this is being thrown around in a very helter-skelter way.
Right.
Sometimes they refer to truth in one way, sometimes they refer to language in another way. And it's all happening in this very kind of mixed up.
Right.
Messed up intellectual space.
And so, correct me if I'm wrong, but it feels like, you know, you and I are both surfers, when the waves are all crashed up, you know, and they're all mixed together. I mean, that's basically what you have.
Oh, yeah.
You have...
what a metaphor.
Right? I mean, but correct me if I'm wrong here. You have this religion. You have religion coming in on one side.
Right.
You have science coming in on another side. And then you have this postmodern suspicion kind of slapping up against everything, throwing everything in turmoil.
Yep.
Because now everybody's suspicious of everything, and it's getting harder and harder to get agreement on something.
Absolutely.
And to quote Rorty, it's easy. If you can get agreement on everything, it's a fact. Otherwise, it's an opinion. So you're taking what... So the modern, I don't know, just anybody today can literally take what we've all agreed to as fact and throw it into an opinion category because you can start to, because you understand on a level much deeper than most people understand that language is up for debate. Yeah. Well, it's up for discussion. It's up for change and manipulation and all of those things.
Well, and people... And again, I don't want to make this ideological, but to give an example of this, people are on both sides of the argument, right? We've slid into a space now where people occupy both a type of metaphysical and post-metaphysical position simultaneously.
When it benefits them the most.
Right.
I'm a God-fearing Christian.
And they may see this is what I don't know, but this is, if there's something troubling about this, this is what is troubling.
Right.
They don't use their metaphysical morality as a strategy. They may actually, in one space of their mind, believe it.
Right. Sure.
God is true.
There's a heaven when we're done.
Yep. There's God's true. This is in some ways this is the word.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Or there's a truth about race. Or there's a truth about justice.
Right. If you're a Platonic philosopher,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Or even nowadays, you know, the social justice movement, right?
Yeah.
Believes, they have to believe at some core level, otherwise they couldn't be making the arguments that they do, that there's some objective truth.
About the morality of what's going on.
About, absolutely.
Okay.
And even Donald Trump, right? Again, he's on both sides of the argument. On one hand, and I'm not going to disbelieve him, I'm going to take him at his word that he's committed to some sort of metaphysical Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
And then yet at the same time, as we were talking about earlier, he deploys language as a sort of discourse of power.
Right.
And he claims the right in a kind of a strange postmodern Nietzschean way, right, even though he's not postmodern, to say, I'm going to say what I want to in language. Right, and for me it's truth.
And for me it's truth, and I believe it.
Right.
And so you should believe it.
Or you better.
Yeah.
So he has a radically subjective notion of truth that he uses in the political discourse on one hand, and he's got a metaphysical notion of truth that he deploys in a moral sense.
Right.
So he's on both sides of it. He's very confused.
Right. Well, I certainly don't.
But I'm not trying to make that as an ideological critique. This is not an ideological show.
No. But more importantly, I don't want to try to dive into what's going on with Donald Trump's mind.
But this is a crime scene. This is what I mean. That
right.
that the people are on multiple sides of the argument simultaneously.
Right.
And they don't understand the origins and implications of the argument.
Right.
And the debates and the boundaries between them. So they move, right? Sometimes they talk about facts in a scientific way. Sometimes they talk about facts in a subjective way.
Right.
Right. Sometimes they talk about truth in a moral way. Right. And it's all sort of messed up and circulating in this sort of hot mess of confusion.
Right. Interesting. Okay. Okay. And so this was part one of the murder mystery.
Yep.
Because on our next episode, if you stay tuned,
right,
we're going to talk about
concrete examples of this.
Of all
fake news, alternate facts, post-truth,
right,
how it functions.
So basically what we tried to do is because you're right, unfortunately, people don't understand
their own conceptions of truth. And their implications of their commitments and the boundaries between the debates.
Such a tough subject. Unfortunately, it's such a tough subject. Yeah. Because I think it strikes at such a core level.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Because it's everything that you understand to be true is being, I use that analogy of being thrown into the washing machine and,
right,
you know.
Right. But people are using the term truth in multiple ways simultaneously. And they're not disentangling.
Right.
Them.
And so as a responsible citizen, it is up to me,
yep,
to untangle.
Understand what you believe truth is, its origins, whether it has a moral implication or a purely scientific implication, and how you're using the word as you engage other people in the political space. Critical.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
All right. Well, time for the shameless plugs. You can't do political philosophy without a coffee mug, so don't forget to buy your DSU coffee mugs on our website. Of course, the donate button is on the top left, as always. And
thanks,
again,
Lisa.
Thanks to Lisa for keeping the lights on.
And our YouTube channel.
Don't forget our YouTube channel.
We have a YouTube channel.
We do have a YouTube channel. I highly recommend
you. You can watch the podcast.
Yeah, you can watch
it. You can watch it.
It's just as riveting as it sounds.
I think more so. I think more so. Are you a visual learner?
Finally, find us on Facebook. Mm-hmm. Again, thanks to Tony Diamond, our producer. Anything else?
I don't think he wants credit for this.
No A in the last name.
No A. D-I-M-O-N-D.
Diamond Media Group.
I guess that's it.
That's it.
I'll
great to see everyone.
Yeah, I will. I feel like I'm forgetting something, but I will. Of course, I will see you on the next one.
Yep. Much love, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.